Howdy. My name is Haley, and I'm an engineering student at the University of Colorado Boulder, studying creative technology and design. Today's lesson is all about roller coasters. We'll learn about how roller coasters work by writing into the physics concepts behind these structures. Have you ever ridden a roller coaster before? Ever wondered how those huge carts climb up a steep hill, then go down and around huge loops at top speed? You'd be surprised to know that most roller coaster carts actually don't have engines inside them to push them along the tracks like cars do. Instead, roller coasters actually harness the power of gravity and physics to move carts along the track. With this in mind, let's get into the science concepts behind a roller coaster's movement and how engineers have cleverly taken advantage of these rules in designing this fun experience. 3, 2, 1, go! The underlying principle of all roller coasters is the law of conservation of energy. This physics law states that energy is neither created nor destroyed, but rather transformed from one form to the other. In the case of roller coasters, the transfer between potential and kinetic energy happens all throughout the track. Let's examine potential energy first. Gravitational potential energy is the energy that an object stores due to its height. In an equation, an object's potential energy is equal to its mass multiplied by its height and something called a gravitational constant. So, what does this have to do with the movement of roller coasters? Because of how the equation works, a cart has the greatest potential energy at the highest point of the track and the lowest potential energy at the bottom point. Cool. What about kinetic energy? Kinetic energy is the energy an object has related to its motion. In an equation, an object's kinetic energy is equal to 1/2 multiplied by the object's mass and its velocity squared. Relating this back to the motion of roller coasters, the cart's kinetic energy is greatest at the lowest point of the track and lowest at the highest point in the track. Did you notice that the potential and kinetic energies are strongest and weakest at opposite times? This explains the transfer between the two energy types throughout the track. Now you know why roller coaster carts always move the fastest at the bottom of hills. This is because at the bottom of these hills, all of the potential energy has been converted to kinetic energy, meaning more speed. On the other hand, the carts move the slowest at the highest point of the track, where there is the highest potential energy and lowest kinetic energy. This is the reason why the first hill of the roller coaster track is always the steepest, to build the most potential energy to help move the cart through the entire track. What would happen if engineers built another hill taller than the first one in the middle of the track? The cart wouldn't have enough energy to get to the top because that hill has more gravitational potential energy than the first hill. That wouldn't make a fun ride. Now that we're energy experts, let's switch over to another science concept behind roller coaster movement, friction. Friction is the force resisting the sliding or rolling of one object on another. The more resistance, the more friction, and vice versa. So, friction happens in all roller coasters due to the rubbing of the cartwheels on the track, and also the slight resistance due to the air around the cart. Friction turns the useful energy of the roller coaster, that being gravitational potential energy and kinetic energy, into heat energy. And as you can probably guess, heat energy doesn't help propel cars along the track. Also, because we can't stop friction from happening, it's a huge challenge for engineers when designing the tracks of these coasters. They have to minimize the effects of friction to keep them going as fast as possible. Next, let's talk loops, which are undoubtedly the scariest part of roller coaster rides. Essentially, the cart can only make it through a loop if it has enough speed at the top of the loop. This minimum speed is known as the critical velocity and has a corresponding equation for engineers to calculate. What do you think would happen if the cart isn't moving fast enough through the loop? It will fall. Uh-oh. Luckily, engineers always make sure that there's enough kinetic energy to power the cart through the loop. They also design carts to have wheels on both sides to keep them attached at all times. Ever felt like you're floating at the top of a hill on a roller coaster? A few times, my whole body has even lifted out of my seat. Another physics concept can explain this phenomenon, acceleration. Acceleration is the rate that an object changes in velocity. At the top of a roller coaster, the cart goes from moving upward to completely flat to moving downward. This means that the acceleration is also changing, causing the riders inside of the cart to feel a force pushing or pulling them. These forces have names too. They are known as gravitational forces, or G-forces. 1G is the force of gravity you'd feel while standing on Earth at sea level. On a roller coaster, we'd feel roughly 3 Gs at the bottom of a steep hill and way less than 1 G at the top of a hill. I hope you learned something new about the movement of roller coasters and how engineers have harnessed the powerful forces of physics in designing their movement. As you go about your day, think about how these forces are acting on you. Can you feel the friction between your feet and the ground as you walk down the street? Or the acceleration of the car or bus you're riding in to get around? What about your own potential energy at the top of the stairs versus the bottom? Well, that's all for today. Thanks for watching this video, and I'll see you next time. Check out the full lesson on the Teach Engineering website. Then, test your knowledge of these physics concepts by designing and building your own model roller coaster in our associated activity, Building Roller Coasters.